one of the most remarkable Christmas songs in pop history.
Well, the opening line is pretty good. It was Christmas Eve, babe, in the drunk tank. You know, you're not getting an ordinary Christmas song when you start a song with that, you know?
For the first time, all eight Pogues go back to the studio where they recorded it 18 years ago. It's the first time they've been into any recording studio in 14 years. Discover what happened when Matt Dillon got completely Pogued.
There's just a lot of drinking going on. That's the Pogues, I mean, drinking.
It's the great Kirsty MacColl song that nearly wasn't.
When we started recording it, we didn't have anyone really lined up as such to sing it. You're a
bum, you're a punk, you're an elf. Meet the man who brought it all together.
Now we have a harp. There is no harp player in the Pogues. You scumbag,
you maggot, and we find out why Shane McGowan enjoys Christmas so much.
Christmas isn't enjoying Christmas. Christmas is hell, you know.
This is the story of Fairy Tale of New York. ...1987, Britain's worst hurricane leaves boats on the beach and trees in houses.
This pile of flotsam is all that's left of the famous Shanklin Pier on the Isle of Wight.
Billions are wiped off shares on Black Monday. T-boy Rick Astley croons up the charts, and professional drinker Shane McGowan finally stumbles into the studio to record the song that will keep him in Long Island iced teas for life. What they recorded is one of the greatest Christmas hits. It's the oral antidote to tinsel and sleigh bells.
You don't normally get Christmas songs of so utterly hopeless.
A sentimental song of booze, bars and massive cars.
It's like a little symphony. Every little bit is bang on.
The Irish jig that leaves Emerald Islanders crying into their Guinness.
It was one of those songs that you held on to tightly because you imagine when you saw the video, you imagine that's how New York looked.
And a lasting testament to singer Kirsty MacColl, killed in a boating accident in the year 2000.
When I ever hear Kirsty singing, it gives me pleasure and joy. And the bells
are ringing out for Christmas. To tell the fairy tale, our handsome prince must meet his beautiful princess. To do that, we must travel back to London in the late 70s, where both Shane McGowan and Kirsty MacColl's careers began. First up, Shane McGowan, an angry young punk with an idea for a band, seen here at an early Clash gig.
We just basically wanted to sound like the Pistols. Yo, I'm
Joe, Shane's first band was the Nipple Erectors, or the Nips. They made lots of noise, but no hits.
I thought they were a brilliant band, and I really liked his songs. You know, I thought they were funny and clever songs and very catchy as well, you know.
It's a classic of its type. Came number one in Italy, yeah? And we broke up the same day, you know.
With the Nips in tatters, Shane went back to his first love, Irish folk music, but with an inspired dose of the Sex Pistols. It was a combination that provided the foundations for Fairy Tale of New York.
Shane had a lot of Irish records, Dubliners, the Furies and so on, and he'd often play them. And there's this misconception that people think we all come from Dublin, you know. Actually, Shane was the only sort of thoroughbred Irish person in the band, really, and he'd spent most of his life living in England.
One day we were around a friend's house and he picked up her guitar and started playing Poor Paddy on the Railway. And it's kind of in a sort of, about 900 miles an hour, I should say.
Shane had discovered the elusive Pogue formula, Irish folk punk.
We'd through every fucking stylistic, fucking rock and roll stylistic thing you could go through, except for that.
it really was so glaringly obvious that really the most surprising thing about it was that nobody had thought of it before us.
Unfortunately for the embryonic Pogues, the UK was in the middle of an IRA bombing campaign. Playing Irish Republican war songs was asking for trouble. The first version of the Pogues were called the New Republicans. 25 years later, Pogue Spider Stacey takes us back to where they played their very first gig. And it's now an Irish theme pub.
This is where the New Republicans did their one and only gig. I just couldn't see that anybody would actually take us seriously. And then I sort of realised that of course I would, because we were actually really good.
When we played here and we were doing like Irish rebel songs in like 1980, 81, whenever it was definitely not a good thing to be Irish, you know what I mean? There was a lot of racism against Irish people.
To make matters worse, the club was full of British soldiers. Fortunately, the only weapons they had were fish and chips.
There was a bunch of scurries in the audience. I mean, like, it was a perfect ending. Like, scurries started pelting us with fish and chips.
While the New Republicans were dodging fish and chips, Kirsty McColl was singing about them. She started her career in a punk outfit called the Drug Addicts, but life in a band was not for her. She soon signed as a solo artist to Stiff Records.
She was with one band, and they were all boys, and she used to come back very depressed that they didn't listen to what she had to say. It was quite funny when Stiff heard them. They only wanted Kirsty. They didn't want the boys.
She really understood country music beautifully. She understood a lot of folk music really well. She understood blues music. She loved, like, kind of Ray Charles. And she kind of, she got all the different elements.
As Kirsty ditched the Drug Addicts, so Shane and the group changed their name from the New Republicans to Pogue Mahone, Gaelic for Kiss My Arse. By now, there were a six-piece with drummer Andrew Rankin, bassist Cotter Reardon, accordionist James Fernley, Jem on banjo, and Spider on beer tray. A recording contract followed, mainly on the strength of their raucous live shows and charismatic lead singer.
Shane was incredibly shy, like the rehearsing up in the West Hampstead. And I remember sitting there and all of a sudden there was no music happening, and I was waiting, you know, and I looked, and I could see Shane was looking at me really uncomfortably. And he didn't want to sing with me in the room. He was just shy, you know what I mean? I said, look, you better get used to it. Now I'm your manager, I'm going to hear you singing all kinds of places.
From the start, their act mixed traditional songs with Shane's originals.
Shane was just a brilliant songwriter. But their reputation was, is they were just cracking live, exhilarating, boisterous noise, basically.
Where's Spider? I'll focus it before I start being bossy. Okay. Okay, I'm going to take a picture.
Bled and Butcher first photographed the Pogues in 1982.
Okay.
Today, he's taking publicity pictures for the 2005 reissue of Fairy Tale of New York.
Acting the goat? Caught.
Beautiful. Okay.
The band is now an eight-piece. The current lineup now includes Terry Woods on mandolin, Philip Chevron on guitar, and Daryl Hunt, who replaced Cotter Reardon on bass.
Ah, it doesn't look better.
I did the first photo session as a band, yeah. I took the photos behind King's Cross, behind the Pindar of Wakefield. I didn't know anything about them then, although the experience was sufficient to make me follow up. They were very weird. Jim wanted to have his banjo in it, so he just sort of went, okay. And Shane wanted to have his pint glass in it.
The Pogues' live reputation helped sales of their first two albums, Red Roses for Me and Rum Sodomy and the Lash. By 1985, manager Frank Murray wanted to turn them into an international act. It was time to visit America. Shane had never visited before, but it was a place that was already alive in his imagination, through films, books, and music. The experience of touring America would inspire the Pogues' greatest song.
Shane was pretty obsessed with America. He'd never been before the band went, so he had this whole mythological America in his mind from films and books and music and so on.
New York turned out to be pretty much the way I imagined it would be. You know?
Fact and fiction merged into one on the tour bus.
Shane and Spider were totally into Once Upon a Time in America and were in character the whole time.
We were watching that sort of like round the clock for the purposes of memorising the script.
It was just motherfucker this and motherfucker that.
This previously unseen footage of their first American concert was shot by Pogues fan Peter Doherty.
This is 2nd Street, and just here on the corner is what used to be a club called The World. That's where I first saw the Pogues. They played there the first gig in America, as far as I know, and it was fantastic. I do remember having a good time, and I remember the woman I was with was saying, let's go. Why do you want to go backstage and say hello? I mean, like, what's your problem? Why would you want to talk to them?
But Peter did go backstage, and another part of the fairy tale of New York jigsaw was in place. Peter would go on to direct the song's video, and he was about to meet its Hollywood star.
Matt Dillon was in the dressing room. I took, there wasn't that much interest in me.
Backstage was packed with celebrity fans, many of them Irish-American.
It was the kind of thing that I liked. It sort of was, you know, it reminded me of, like, the Dubliners or the Clancy Brothers mixed with the Clash. Immediately, I was a big fan.
The Pogues' blend of nostalgia and punk had struck a chord with Irish-Americans like Matt Dillon and Peter Doherty. At the same time, Shane McGowan had been inspired by stories of ancestors who had struggled to make a new life thousands of miles away from Ireland.
In Ireland, like, you're either dead or in America. If you're in America, you're not coming back.
Before the Pogues' trip to America, Kirsty MacColl had caught the eye of the man who would go on to produce Fairy Tale of New York.
I first met Kirsty MacColl when I was producing Simple Minds. She came down to do some backing vocals, and she was a big fan of Simple Minds, and she was out there doing the vocals, and I thought, I'm going to marry that girl.
The couple were married within months. Kirsty's career was also going well, thanks to a string of bittersweet songs about relationships.
A lot of her songs were quite vitriolic about men. And people would always say, oh, is that song about you? And I go, no. And she would never, she'd always say, they're not about anyone. They're about mixtures of people I meet. And, you know, great social comment, a great girl's girl.
While Kirsty was getting married, the Pogues were getting famous.
The Pogues were growing all the time, you know. They just kept going from strength to strength.
Every time, like, we caused enough damage to get barred from a club, you know, we moved up a notch, you know.
But the band needed a big single to break into the mainstream.
So I just thought, well, it'd be really interesting to see what they do with a Christmas song. So that's why I asked them initially to do it. And we were supposed to be covering a song.
Instead of looking for a song to cover, banjo player Jem Finer and Shane attempted to write a duet, but at the time they didn't have Kirsty MacColl in mind. It was written for the Pogues' female bassist, Cotta Reardon.
She was a great singer, and she had an amazing pair of... And she was a beautiful-looking young girl, like, and none of the rest of us were by any stretch of the imagination. Yeah.
Jem started with a traditional approach.
I wrote one Christmas duet, which had, you know, it was really, actually the words were crap and the whole idea behind it was sort of sentimental Christmas rubbish.
He came up with something more Pogue-like about the couple down on their luck at Christmas, then took it to Shane, who came up with the New York connection.
We decided to make it about two Irish immigrants on the way out. Like, you know, they'd had their glory days in well, it explains it in the song, yeah?
Here exclusively is the demo of Fairy Tale of New York. It also features original vocalist Cotta Reardon. With a song taking shape and demos laid down with producer Elvis Costello, all that remained was the final recording session and the small matter of a title.
And Costello said, like, what are you going to call it? Christmas Eve in the Drunk Tank? With, you know, amazing imagination, that guy. No, that's not pretentious enough, you know? I thought, yes, Fairy Tale of New York. You know, I was looking at the book cover, yeah? Fairy Tale of New York, you know?
Fairy Tale of New York was written by Irish-American J.P. Donlevy in 1973. It's a story of a young man who arrives in America from Ireland. Shane met Donlevy in Dublin.
He explained to me that it was his father was a big fan of mine and read most of the books, I believe, and he did this as a favour to his father, in effect, to recognise the fact that his father read my books and was a fan. I was surprised. I thought it was a really striking piece of music with wonderful overtones, and I realized straight away that it didn't really have anything to do with my book at all.
The Pogues' Christmas single was really coming together. It had lyrics, a tune, and a title. But despite repeated attempts, they weren't happy with the recordings.
The song wasn't really whole. It was just like it was a great song, but, you know, we hadn't given much thought to it, you know?
The band just couldn't play it very well either. And I think time kind of ran out. I wasn't going to... If you're going to have a Christmas song, it has to be out for Christmas. To the landlord's father's
lair. 15 minutes later. The band went back on the road, becoming tighter and more ambitious. But they kept working on their Christmas single.
We started to put in the set, so it became a different song, very tight.
But the constant touring was too much for bassist Cotta Reardon. She married producer Elvis Costello and decided to leave the band.
That was extremely distressing because they didn't really know what to do. I mean, they deputised Daryl and it worked, but I think it was just basically from partying too hard.
The band replaced their bassist, but in 1986, Fairy Tale had lost its female voice.
You know, it was never going to be scrapped. It was just, you know, I know, you know, Shane was always tinkering.
No, I was trying to finish the bloody song.
Whenever we got together to rehearse and there was a new fiddle about, we'd try and play it again.
Shane finally nailed the lyrics in Scandinavia after a bout of pneumonia.
You get lots of delirium and stuff, yeah? And so I got quite a few really good images out of that.
Pogue's New York Christmas epic was about to be recorded, but when they arrived at the studio in the summer of 1987, there was still no female vocalist to sing alongside Shane.
When we started recording it, it was still there, written as a duet, but we didn't have anybody, anyone really lined up as such to sing it.
Despite this, the band went into the studio in London with their new producer, Steve Lillywhite. Steve was used to working with stadium rock acts like Simple Minds and U2, not with penny whistles and banjos.
If you would have said, like, 8 months beforehand, we'd get Steve Lillywhite, it would have been a no. We wouldn't have thought of using Steve, you know. But somehow when the band came off that sort of, like, 18 months of touring and they had become this really, really tight unit.
I knew I was getting a band who were at their best, You know, I think I was very lucky to get them when I got them, because there was a great feeling of momentum towards the Pogues. And I, you know, I helped ride that. Husband, but please don't mess with
my man. Steve didn't only bring top-end production to the Pogues, he also brought his new wife. Kirsty MacColl had tried out a range of musical styles across a number of albums, but had never managed a mainstream hit. The money my husband made
used to buy peas and rice. Kirsty just had her own way. She was a great singer, she wrote great songs. They didn't have mass appeal. If you listen to her album, Galore, you know, which is like her greatest hits, sort of, it's a great album. You know, there's really great songs on it.
One of the many great things about Kirsty MacColl was the fact that she had a great understanding of all sorts of music, and there were no musical barriers for her. Walking down Madison,
I swear I never had it. But despite her strengths, Kirsty was never comfortable performing live. She suffered from stage fright, which was at its worst on a tour of Ireland.
I was concerned for her. I got a postcard, which really worried me, because it wasn't written by Kirsty at all. It was written by one of the band, and it was, "Dear Mum, things are going rather better. I have stopped throwing up." I saw two shooting stars
last night. I wished them there, but they were only satellites. It took her a long time to feel at home going on the stage. You know, it really did. She wasn't like in those days. She wasn't a natural performer.
In 1985, she hit the top 10 with a cover of Billy Bragg's New England. But 2 years later, Kirsty would discover a cure for her stage fright when she recorded an even bigger single in a duet with Shane McGowan. Kirsty's contribution to Fairy Tale of New York happened almost by accident. She'd often pop into the studio to see Steve, and on one visit, Shane suggested she have a go singing the female lead.
Shane sung the whole song, and he gave me a set of the lyrics, and this is where Kirsty sings, this bit, that bit. It was sort of obvious because, you know, but it was good that he did that.
Steve had a recording studio at his house and took the demo back for Kirsty to try out.
So I played it to Kirsty and then cleaned the sections of where she should sing. So she responded to his vocal as if he was there, but, you know, he wasn't there, and she didn't ever sing it with him. You promised me Broadway was waiting for me. You were handsome.
When the band finished playing, they howled out for more. And they did some work on the home studio, and they came in with this vocal on it, and it just sounded perfect, you know, just perfect. The boys of the NYPD choir
still singing Galway Bay. And then he brought it back and played it to us, and it was like, hang on, this is, like, really good. That's it, you know, bingo.
Finally, Fairy Tale had its female lead. Producer Steve Lillywhite takes us through the master tapes.
Now we have a harp. There is no harp player in the Pogues. How did this come about?
Rack Studios, North London. For the first time in 14 years, the instruments are being set up for the arrival of all eight Pogues, including notoriously unreliable Shane McGowan.
Shane thought he was going to a rehearsal tomorrow.
Right.
Maybe it's best to let him keep thinking that, actually. Though maybe not, because, I mean, usually when it's rehearsals, he turns up 6 days later.
The band started work here in July 1987 and spent 4 weeks working on their third album, If I Should Fall From Grace With God. It was these sessions that produced Fairy Tale of New York. Hopefully today, all eight musicians are back.
Andrew Rankin on the drums. Daryl on the bass. Terry Woods.
Yeah.
James Fernley. And Philip Chevron. Jam. And Spider Stacy.
And just 2 hours late, Shane McGowan.
She's looking well.
Still going despite extraordinary rock and roll indulgences. Rack Studios represented a move up in the world for the Pogues.
before recording here, we'd recorded in Elephant Studios, which is kind of...
It's difficult.
It's kind of cold, damp basement in Wapping, so being here with a bit of light coming in and stuff, it was kind of nice.
Well, also, because the place is quite big, you can put... You can play live as a band.
Just learning the song that we didn't learn the first time round, right?
Recording wasn't always easy for the band. Their DIY punk roots means they don't all read music.
We had countless arguments because people would count things in different ways. So you'd say, right, you know, there's eight of that bit and then there's four of the other bit because their one is twice someone else's one. You know, like our sort of communication of musical ideas was sometimes quite fraught, you know.
I do know it. I think all we need to know is the first one.
The first one is the one that goes to the end.
The first one, you mean when there's still the singing going on?
No, it's not. Not at that point.
I remember. Once I had no idea how to play this. So I don't know if it was not on the set list or something like that. I couldn't get past the first couple of notes. And I beseeched Philip to tell me how it went. And he kept shouting it to me, but I couldn't hear because the crowd was just going mad. It was hopeless.
It's all Bohemian Rhapsody, you know what I mean? You know what I mean?
Yeah, this was a new level of sophistication.
Yeah.
It took a while to get it.
People always say, oh, the Pogues, they're a rabble-rousing, drinking bunch, but they're so serious about their music. I learnt a lot. You know, their arrangements were very good in terms of keeping the listener interested.
Steve now lives in Manhattan, but he's gone into a studio in America to revisit the multi-track master recordings of Fairy Tale of New York.
I've not heard this song for about 18 years. I'm going to attempt to give you some idea of what it was like to record this song. Oh, what a fantastic start. I think that was James Fearnley, that line.
It was Christmas Eve, babe.
Yeah, it's a song of three parts. And I think we recorded this intro separately. And the voice was recorded at the same time as the piano. I think if I solo the voice, I'll find out. That's not the voice. You can hear the piano in the background. So it's a performance between piano and voice only.
The track's piano opening was recorded separately to the main body, and then the two were edited together.
So the edit, just coming up here. Terry Wood's there!
During the recordings, certain instruments like Terry Wood's mandolin were multiplied to help give the song an epic feel.
That mandolin there, we did some massed mandolins, I think maybe even at half speed, where you slowed the tape down and you go like brrrr, and when you speed it back up it goes brrrr, like that, much faster. Very nice, and that's, I'd forgotten all about that. Damn, I need to remix this song. Everyone talking in the background. Pristine recording. There, you got to use that, haven't you? Spider would do that a lot, whenever he made a mistake.
Spider Stacy's penny whistle was key to the Pogues' sound, but it wasn't an instrument that stadium rock veteran Steve was familiar with.
And I'd be mixing away, And every time I go back to the beginning and it had started, I go, "Oh, that whistle's a bit loud," you know, because I'm not used to hearing it. So I'd always every time I'd make the whistle quieter and quieter because of its high pitchedness. Your ear always goes to it, so I'd always keep turning it down. Then the band would come in and go, "Well, sounds great, Steve, but where's Spider?" I go, "Look, there he is, really loud." "Oh, no, he isn't."
And you really got a favourite bit?
Okay. Now we're in the home stretch.
The soaring orchestral climax, that's quite good.
Yeah.
The final.
Well, yeah, the end.
Final,
well, yeah, so we're rebelling towards the end.
Bit, the final verse and the. Yeah, I mean, it's the best bit, I think.
That ending is important, yeah. Curse is important.
The song really moves me, actually, I've got to say.
At long last, the Pogues and Kirsty MacColl had pulled it off. After 2 years writing and a month recording, Fairy Tale of New York was complete. All it needed now was a video, and it got a black and white classic with a cameo performance from Hollywood heartthrob.
I don't remember much about it, but I think the reason I don't remember much about it is different than why other people don't remember it. Because I wasn't drunk, but, you know, and that's the truth. I can say that's the truth.
Matt Dillon played a police officer who has to throw a drunken Shane McGowan into a cell. It sounded straightforward.
I wanted him to just grab Shane by the elbow, but he wanted to know how aggressive am I, you know, and I said, "Look, it's Christmas Eve, you don't want to be working, you know, you're sick of picking up drunks, but you certainly are not going to throw him down the stairs, so you're not happy, but you're not beating him on the way up the stairs."
Well, I think there had to be a little bit of, I mean, he was pretty liquored up anyway, so when I was holding his arm, it really was, you know, I mean, he could have gone down the stairs, you know.
Peter Doherty was going, "Look, Matt, just forget Shane is your friend, like, you know. Look, just fucking beat the shit out of me, push me through the fucking door, we can get things done, man, you're an actor." In the end, he did it properly, you know. It's great.
The start of the video was shot in a New York police station.
Yeah, this is it. Here on the left, the flag outside.
Manager Frank Murray and extra Dennis Driscoll are going back for the first time in 18 years. Behind Shane and Matt, you can see Dennis. He's on the right with his back to camera, arresting a genuinely drunken Father Christmas.
I was just trying to hold on to him to make it authentic, and he was like, "You're not gonna take me alive," and like, you know, just screaming, you know?
Everybody pretty much was in quite a state for it, but I guess it was, that was the theme of it, wasn't it?
Drunk
tank.
So
down below and then the tombs here, we had cells, and they were, we were using them as dressing rooms and hangout, you know, a place to hang out before you got called. And it was quite funny because what was going down on in the cells, if anybody had known about it, we would have been put in the cells locked up.
Well, I remember when Shane walked in, he had a margarita under his jacket and they saw it immediately and they grabbed him. No.
We nearly all got arrested as well because we did the jail scenes in the real Nick, yeah? And we were all getting really pissed.
So they stuck me in a holding room. It was really like a holding cell because it was a jail cell with Shane and I think the road manager, the guy had long blonde hair and he was dressed in a Santa Claus costume. And the two of them, you know, there was no way, even if I wanted to jump in, I could never catch up with them because they were so out there at that point.
All the drinking in the cells was starting to make the police anxious. Thankfully, there was a screen icon there to smooth the ruffled feathers.
Matt Dillon being sober was a big plus, though. I think he pretty much saved the day. Peter was getting a lot of flack from the cops. They were, like, not having it. They were not happy at all. And Matt went over and talked to him, and then we just did it and got out, you know, and it worked really well. I think him being there really saved the day.
You were pretty queen of New York City when the band finished playing. They held up.
The biggest challenge in the video was the chorus. The boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay.
The boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay. And the bells were ringing out for Christmas.
The boys of the NYPD choir, which I don't think that really exists.
Yeah, the boys of the NYPD choir, and there is no PD choir, so it was, you know, what are we going to get that is sort of a group of police doing something quote-unquote musical.
They ended up with the police department's Irish pipe band.
They don't play Irish pipes and they wear tartan, you know, there's a few culturally confusing elements.
I remember the night pretty well because I was fairly new in the band, but we had a performance that night up in one of the big hotels, and after that we had a bus take us to do the video.
Everybody wanted to go. We all wanted to go down there, no matter how cold it was. And we filled the bus up with beer and we went down to meet them.
And the Pogues got wind that we had beer in the bus. They come on the bus with us. They drank a lot of our beer, I remember that.
But the Pogues maintain it was the police who were the real drinkers.
These guys got out of the coach, and they were legless. I mean, whatever we were.
They were drinking all day, and then they got downtown, and they started chanting, no beer, no show. They weren't getting off the bus until they got beer.
The boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay.
I don't think they knew Galway Bay. I'm trying to remember what they sang.
It wasn't Galway Bay. They asked us to sing a song we all knew the words to.
They didn't have exactly a repertoire of, you know, Irish songs, put it that way.
We were singing the Mickey Mouse theme song.
Yeah.
But I remember us doing that. That was quite fun, singing Mickey Mouse, M-I-C-K-E-Y, M-O-U-S-E, yeah.
The boys of the NYPD chorus are singing Galway Bay, and the bells are ringing out.
In December 1987, the video was complete and the record was released in time for Christmas.
I absolutely adore this new record. Hope it's going to be number one for Christmas. The Pogues and Kirsty MacColl and the fabulous fairy tale of New York. This is great.
It was Christmas Eve, babe.
Before it came out, I went to a bookies in Camden Town and I asked them, what were they given on the Christmas number one single? So we're not really doing anything on the job. And so they said, who you want to bet on? I said, the Pogues. They said, who are they? I said, just put down the Pogues, find out. So they rang headquarters, you know, whatever. And they gave me 50 to 1.
A lot of people started betting on it really early, yeah? Friends of ours, yeah? And it spread, you know?
And then when that went in, I was down to 20 to 1. Because, like, I'd get braver every day. I'd go ahead and have a little bit more on that, you know?
Got on the lucky one. Came in at 10 to 1.
It started to hot up because it did start to go up the charts, and then it became actually like, shit, this could actually be like a hit.
Right, stand by your turkeys, here comes the Christmas top 10. Down 3 at 10, what do you want to make those eyes at me for? Shaky. Former number 1, Topal's China in Your Hand, is down at 9.
All I can remember is like lying on the floor listening to successive numbers, you know, always hoping as they came to announce it, it wasn't going to be Fairy Tale of New York.
Rick Astley's When I Fall in Love, down 2 at 4. Up 3-3, Rocket Around the Christmas Tree, Mel and Kim.
They played number 3, whatever that was. So Fairy Tale is going to be either number 2 or number 1. And then they announced number 2 and it's like that horrible instant where you're just waiting for the first syllable sort of what it is, you know, and as soon as it's, you know, shit.
Up 6-2, The Fairy Tale of New York from the Pogues and Kirsty MacColl.
If you ask any artist, they'll tell you that the most prestigious chart position is a Christmas number one.
What was that song, the Elvis song? Anyway, there's two queens and a drum machine beat us.
Here are the Pet Shop Boys, always on my mind!
I was actually really annoying and disappointing.
I thought it was a disgusting fucking record. It was a cynical, jaded, pathetic, like, sort of... I quite liked the Pet Shop Boys before that.
The record was a hit and the video's a classic, but what makes a good song great? We speak to the finest musical minds.
I think having it lay on the shelf for 2 years probably was very good for the song, actually. I mean, there are pieces that turn up in Beethoven that were first sketched out 15 years before they actually found their rightful place. So, yeah, let them marinate.
One of Fairy Tale of New York's main influences was Ennio Morricone's score for Once Upon a Time in America, a film the band watched repeatedly on their tour bus.
The main influence for the first notes that you hear is from Ennio Morricone, basically. You know, that's you know, from Once Upon a Time in America.
Fairy Tale is a mix of two distinct songs, the piano start and then the main body, as Gary Carpenter, a classical composer from the Royal Academy of Music, demonstrates.
It's kind of like A Day in the Life of the Beatles, which is also two songs that are grafted together. Whereas this, because he actually takes the opening tune, which is this. Uses that later in the song so that he does. And so forth. So, in other words, it provides a kind of unity. So, in fact, although it is two songs, it doesn't feel like it.
The Pogues also stole a musical trick from the classics, but they weren't the first modern songwriters to do it.
That's a very expressive harmonic gesture. It's what, in classical terms, is referred to as an appoggiatura.
It was Christmas Eve, babe, in the drunk tank.
You get it, for example, in the start of Yesterday. You know, if he went, Yesterday, I don't think it would be covered 212,000 times. You know, I mean, who cares? That is what gives it the particular effect, and the same goes here.
It's like a little symphony. You know, every little bit is bang on, you know. The way the whole thing's constructed is just a beautiful work in itself. You can admire it just for that.
This feels like it's been constructed. It's been worked. It's a craftsman-like song. It's very well put together.
Feature of Pogue's songs are Shane McGowan's lyrics. Heavily influenced by the greats of Irish literature, they stand up well to close analysis.
It's a classic New York tale, isn't it? Two people coming to New York, all wide-eyed, and she ends up as a junkie, I think. And he's in a drunk tank, so it's a great Christmas song. There should be more of them.
Singer Nick Cave and Shane McGowan have been friends for years, but they work in very different ways.
He would sing me songs that he'd written, and, I mean, great stuff, great lyrics, which a lot of them never saw the light of day, and he would be picking up scraps of paper from the floor and going, oh, I've got another one, type of thing, and singing stuff, and it was really, really powerful stuff.
Shane McGowan's lyrics are consistently good, but Fairy Tale of New York is considered one of his best.
It can be reduced by the likes of me into an old couple, you know, having a bit of a Barney on Christmas Eve. But that's not really what it's about.
To really understand the lyrics to Fairy Tale of New York, we need to know about Irish-American history. For over 250 years, Irish immigrants have been arriving in America. The lyrics are about their dreams of a new life and their memories of home. We gather together three Irish-American historians at Ellis Island, the immigration centre where new arrivals, after travelling for thousands of miles, were screened before being allowed into the US. It's now a tourist attraction.
You finally get it, you see the Statue of Liberty, and then you hold your breath to get to make it through those checkpoints down there at the desks, and then that's on to wherever you were going.
Many a dream were dashed right here in these very halls. When you think about, they made it this far, you know, over whatever journey to get to this point, and then they realized that they weren't getting through.
For all the gold the world might hold.
Many Irish immigrants who did manage to get through U.S. customs had a struggle ahead. Songs like Galway Bay and The Rare Old Mountain Dew are mentioned in the lyrics of Fairy Tale of New York, tapping into Irish-American nostalgia.
And I lay my bones neath churchyard stones beside you, Galway Bay.
The world of Galway Bay, the world of John Ford's Quiet Man, the world of an imagined Ireland is very much a diasporic world. And that's one that's heavily nostalgic and heavily sentimental. And bang, we're being hit up against this in the very song, where sentiment meets sadness.
Happy Christmas, your arse. I pray God it's our last.
And these are clearly immigrants, because they're saying Happy Christmas rather than Merry Christmas, your arse.
References to Sinatra swinging and cars as big as bars point to the 50s, but the song has a more contemporary relevance. Shane McGowan wrote it at a time when many of his countrymen were forced to leave Ireland and head to America.
I think it's the timing of it. 1987 was really the peak period of immigration, new immigration out of Ireland to the United States. So that young generation of people who would be listening to Shane McGowan and the Pogues and being in the bars, they'd relate to it on a very serious level.
Could have been someone.
Well, so could anyone.
Around 100,000 young Irish moved to the US in the mid-80s when the song was written. For the families they left behind, America was a place of their dreams.
Kieran, my eldest brother, would have went in 85, 86. Because there was no jobs really in Ireland. We were constantly chatting to them on the phone, and they were telling us the stories of New York and how amazing it was, and how we, I mean, I guess it was, I was next, you know, when I got to the age, I would have gone myself, but luckily I, you know, got into Boyzone and things changed. But so when that song came out, it was one of those songs that you held on to tightly, because you imagine when you saw the video, you imagine that's how New York looked.
The words and music give the song a filmic quality. Not surprising when you remember what they spent their time watching on the tour bus.
But it has this view of New York which is actually totally unreal and romantic and right out of the movies.
I think Shane McGowan's work, in that funny way, it actually does capture something about America and particularly New York City, but something you would never be aware of.
I kept them with me, babe. I kept them with my own. Can't make it on my own. I built my dreams around you. I mean, that's a really strong moment, and that's beautiful.
A lot of people think they can write songs, but to be that poetic is very hard to sort of achieve, you know, certain simplicity and sort of hitting the nail.
But one of the strengths of the song is that it doesn't tell you everything, like what happens in the end.
Can't make it all alone. I built my dreams around you.
You don't know what happens at the end, you know. It's a, you know, I mean, it's unlikely they go get around the Christmas tree and swap presents, but in the end, I don't know what happens. But it has an uplifting ending, you know what I mean? Like, because love never dies, kind of, you know.
I kept them with me, babe. I put them with my own. I can't make it.
The song's mix of emotional lyrics and complex melody has attracted several cover versions. Irish folk singer Christy Moore recorded it as a solo vocal.
You're a bum, you're a punk, you're an owl, whore and junk, lying there under the drip, nearly dead in the bed.
Christy Moore is good. Really good. He takes a totally different take, and he does it not as a duet, and he does it as Christie's in his own style.
Holy Squire, we're singing.
Galway Bay. Not all versions have been so well received.
On Christmas Day. The only thing you can ever do with a cover version of Fairy Tale of New York is try and find a different approach to it. Try and find something in it that we haven't said.
Because I had so many brothers and sisters living in America, that song became very important to me. And I always tried to cover songs that were important to me and that I had great memories of.
But Ronan's management had some reservations about him going all Shane McGowan on them and censored the song's lyrics.
The only problem, I think, was the faggot phrase. But we had to change it, I mean, what can you do?
If you're going to sing Fairy Tale of New York and you're going to change the words, why bother?
You scumbag, you maggot, you're cheap and you're haggard was the lyric we had to change to. I mean, OK, it's fair enough. It doesn't really do any harm to the song, changing it.
Brian Keegan, yeah. I still that was good. The best versions I've heard are people singing it in bars, actually, yeah.
Exactly like the audience at a Pogues gig, Shane and Kirsty's performance was a showstopper.
Kirsty McCall.
Kirsty was in her element with the band, and the fans just loved her. They really did. It was when her name was mentioned, there was such an outpouring of, you know, love.
This song's called Fairy Tale of New York.
Performing with the Pogues was the perfect cure for Kirsty's stage fright. She went back in front of a crowd for the first time in 7 years.
It was very moving. I found it so moving. And that's what's so extraordinary. I mean, I'm so glad I saw her. That was really so exciting.
There's the part of the song where Shane says, I could have been someone. And Kirsty goes, well, so could anyone. And you'd have a hall full of 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 people all singing, so could anyone, back at the band. And it was an extraordinary moment. It was spine tingling sometimes. I used to just wait for it every night because it was, you know, catch Kirsty's eye in the middle of it if I was lucky.
Fairy Tale in New York is not a Pogues song, it's the Pogues and Kirsty McCall, you know.
But a week before Christmas 2000, something happened which meant the song would never again be played in its original form.
Pop singer Kirsty McCall has been killed in an accident in Mexico. She was
Kirsty was hit by a speedboat while swimming with her two sons on holiday. Her mother got a telephone call at home.
Then he just said there's been an accident and a boating accident and Kirsty's dead. And oh well, what can I say?
Oh, yes, sir.
Gold, but the wind goes right through you, it's no place for the old. When you first took my hand on a car.
When we were in there listening to it sort of choked me a little bit. You are handsome. Whenever I listen to Kirsty's voice in a studio situation, it takes me back. Sinatra was swinging, all the drunks they were singing. It was just so sad when she was taken from us.
It was a real horrible shock. Kind of unbelievable and incomprehensible and nightmarish. It still is, actually.
Every year near her birthday, Kirsty's relatives and fans gather around her memorial in Soho Square to sing her songs and remember her life. This is their fifth year.
What would be lovely would be if Kirsty was here singing her bit, So Could Anyone. You know, I sing that with like everybody does, with a real, you know, power.
When I ever hear Kirsty singing, it gives me pleasure and joy. They got cars big as bars, they got rivers of gold, but the wind goes right through you, it's no place for the old. When you first took my hand on a cold,
Christmas Eve. You promised me Broadway was waiting for me.
You were pretty queen of New York City.
Fairy Tale comes on. First of all, I go, oh, not that again. And within a minute, I'm sucked into the song all over again, as if I'm hearing it for the first time.
The bars of the NYPD chorus still sing, going
by. I want to do people and families sit around the Christmas table, Christmas Day, singing it. Okay, you be Kirsty and you'll be I'll be Shane.
I'm proud of us, you know, and everybody involved in it, you know, and Kirsty, and, you know, proud of everybody involved in it, you know.
You took my dreams from me when I first found you.
It's a great Christmas song. You don't normally get Christmas songs about so utterly hopeless.
Can't make it all alone. I built my dreams around you. The boys of the NYPD chorus still singing, go away, play. And the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day.